11:56 a.m. on April 25, 2015, the moment when time stopped and Earth started shaking. Nepal was hit by a massive 7.8 magnitude earthquake that day. And this is our collective story. It was a lazy Saturday, as far as I can remember, with gray overcast sky, and it looked as if the clouds were trying to rain down on us, but they were hesitant for some reason. It looked as if they knew something would happen in the next few moments. And at that moment, I was taking a shower. So as you can imagine, that's not one of my proudest decisions in my life. But suddenly, the earth started to shake violently. And the buckets I had in front of me were moving from side to side, back and forth. The water in those buckets, I'd never seen it so agitated, so menacing, so devastating. And the sheer sound, the roar of your building shaking to its very core, it was so loud, so deafening, there is nothing that you could hear in that noise. But eventually, it stopped. I rushed out of my house on the streets, and on the streets, in that dust, I could only hear people wailing and crying. I couldn't see them in that dust. It looked as if the dust had lost its confidence on the ground and just refused to settle. But eventually, the dust settled down. And when it did, both figuratively and literally, we as a nation faced one of the most momentous challenges in our history. The longer-term goal after that thing was that we were building back, we had to build back better. But that was a longer-term goal. One of the shorter-term implications of that thing was that we had to do a data survey of around 1 million houses, which basically means that we need to go to 1 million houses, collect data, and then identify beneficiaries, like who are eligible to receive housing assistance from the government of Nepal. Now, traditionally, that would have meant sending thousands of surveyors to field with stacks of paper questionnaire, conduct survey for months, bring back heaps of filled-up forms, spend another few months in transcribing the data, and then only start analyzing data to formulate intervention plans. But this time, the government of Nepal took a radical decision. And this story is about that. I'm going to talk about how a 7.8 mag earthquake started a digital revolution in Nepal. This time, we used electronic tablets. It meant we had better data quality, we had zero transcription time and cost, we had shorter turnaround period, we had enhanced data security, we had richer data set because we had the GPS locations of each of those million households. We also had pictures of those houses. And it also enabled us to have a near real-time data status of what's happening on field. Now, one of the biggest advantages of using digital technology for this survey is this. Nearly 76% of the total data to be surveyed were collected and usable within the first 100 days of the survey. Imagine this, if this would have been possible using paper, pen and paper survey. But of course, achieving this was not a mean feat. There were many non-tech challenges, there were many technical challenges, and in this, all partners, NRA was there to provide us overall guidance. CBS was the lead in this project. Kathmandu Building Labs had the responsibility of providing tech support for this whole project. There were Heard International and Real Solutions managing 2,500 teams of surveyors on field at any given time. There was UNOPS who was managing all of these things. But then all of those non-tech challenges, but as a tech company, KLM had the specific challenges of achieving these things. Now we all know how stable and reliable internet is in Nepal. So our first job was to make an application which would work totally offline, at least while collecting data on field. The second was we had to compress photos. Each of the records would have around 10 photos, and the device that we were using at that time, the least size that it could capture was 5 megabytes. So that means one record would be about 50 megabytes. What we had to do was we had to shrink it down to about 0.4 megabyte, about 8% of the total size, without reducing much quality. Third, we had to upload photos separately from text data. Again, it's because of the internet. And what we had to do with this was like, we had to build a system in which we would have been able to send an email, for example, with photos, but then if the internet is not good enough, it would automatically just send your email first, and then send your photos later on. But without having you to take the trouble of deciding which photos goes to which emails. That's the kind of system we developed for this thing. The other thing, as Sir mentioned, the battery life. And then the challenge was like, we needed to have real-time data of what was happening on field. But then if internet is not a given thing, how do we do that? We realized that there is a continuum of technological possibilities. Internet is not the only way of being connected. There are other lesser known advanced technologies like SMS. So we even use those where people, the surveyors on field, just text us and say that these are the numbers of houses we've completed today. They do not need to send us all the data, but just numbers. But that would give us a good example of what's happening there. So an output of all of these things, when we overcame both tech and non-tech challenges, were that something like this. We had a more secure portal where we knew what was happening. We had NHR, we had this all, they could download these data in different formats. They could take different kind of reports, and we could also monitor them in almost real time, like what was happening, what's the status in each district, in each VDC, in each ward, what's happening there. All of these kinds of things. And the beauty of this thing was, these system was in work, not after they came back from field. It was there working, monitoring their work, monitoring the quality of their work while they were on the field. And all of this was possible because we took the decision of using electronic devices for the survey. Now one of the larger output of this thing is that we have about 1.05 million records in our database, which is about 5.0, we reached about 5 million people. We have 9.34 million photos on us on the server, and the whole database is about 10 terabytes in size. But on the larger outputs, I will go with the larger outputs. This is the obvious output. This is what we had to do. But I think one of the larger outputs is that this, as we told you, is one of the largest surveys. To the best of our knowledge, it's the biggest mobile survey done in such a short period of time. And this data set is not just about the damaged data set, it also contains the GPS locations, the photos of those houses, and it also contains socio-economic profiles of individual residents in each of those houses. So it's not just damaged data, it's a very rich set of data which we can use, integrate with the other existing sources of data, and by virtue of which we can make more timely, more informed decisions. As a matter of fact, we are now working with the National Reconstruction with the National Planning Commission to make this data more accessible, more understandable, more useful to the wider audience. We're developing a system to work on that thing. Let's talk about some outcome first. I think one of the biggest outcome of this whole project is a paradigm shift. Thank you, Namsa. So one of the biggest outcomes of this thing is the paradigm shift that we have when it comes to now data collection, data visualization triggered by this project. I think by taking this decision by NRA and CBS, we have now potentially transformed the way forever, like how Nepal would now collect, view, and perceive data. But perhaps the biggest outcome of this project is the story of grit and inspiration that Nepal has to offer to the world. An outstanding example of solidarity in the face of a crisis. How the government, civil society, tech innovators, and the nation's people came together and added a new dimension of building back better. Honorable Chair, distinguished panel of speakers, ladies and gentlemen, we're stuck. Honorable Chair, distinguished panel of speakers, ladies and gentlemen, yes, the earth shook that day, but it also helped us unshackle some of the bureaucratic shackles that we have and help us move forward and do things in a better way. Yes, the time froze at that moment, but when it resumed, we started in a new area, in new era, where we could now do things in a better way. I stand here both proud and humbled to share this story, our story of grit, determination, and never-say-die spirit. I thank you all for your time and patience, and I thank you for the parts you've all played in making it happen. Thank you.